Hello and welcome to Argue the Toss from GameIndustry.com. I'm Chella.
And I'm Drew, and together we're arguing about the things that really matter in game.
Indeed we are, and welcome to this special edition show of Argue the Toss.
Yeah. It's the end of the year, and you know that what that means. Everyone's giving away their Game of the Year awards and all sorts of best of year lists. And we thought, you know, why should we be any different?
Exactly.
So this is our Game Awards for 2016, the inaugural tosses, which are the awards that we're going to be giving out. We've got a few categories to go through.
Yeah, we do.
We've gone away and thought long and hard, analysed every game that's been released this year.
Oh, at least the ones we've managed to play, because I think it's actually been a really good year, 2016.
It really has. Like, it was surprisingly, so going back through, I mean, to do this episode, I went back through just a list of basically everything that's been released this year.
Yeah. And
there was a lot more good stuff that I've played this year than I realised.
Yeah, yeah. And there's a lot of good stuff that I still haven't managed to get around to playing.
Yep,
so, yeah, there's some really good stuff that I need to catch up on as well.
I mean, you were saying you haven't gotten around to Final Fantasy 15 yet. I haven't managed to get into The Last Guardian yet.
So, yeah.
Like, this is a tentative list.
Maybe next
episode we'll come back and just scrap it all. And
We were wrong.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's jump in with the first Totter Award is for Biggest Surprise.
Yeah.
So it's the game that you played and didn't expect it to be as good as it was, or didn't expect to enjoy it as much.
Absolutely. Do you want to go first for this one, or shall I?
I can go first if you like.
Go for it.
So my one, my biggest surprise is Watch Dogs 2.
Okay, yeah, like, I've heard about this, yeah.
I can't believe I'm saying that. Because I was bitterly disappointed by Watch Dogs. I thought it would have done really interesting things with hacking in a post-Snowden era and, you know, personal data, security and government sort of control of our personal information. But it didn't. It gave us a really boring character.
Yeah.
And the hacking was crap. And, yeah, so Watch Dogs 2 kind of turns that around. We've got a black male lead character who wears glasses instead of having a gun. He uses his brains. He's a hacker and he's part of this kind of underground crew. And it's just, I went into it to review it and I was just like, okay, I'm just going to play it and see how it is. And I've just been like, oh, I don't want to trade this in yet. I want to keep playing. So yeah, it's quite engaging. The characters, the kind of group of hackers, are quite fun, and it just feels a bit like a GTA with hacking. The dialogue's maybe not quite as good, but it's less kind of crude satire. It's set in San Francisco, so it's a really nice setting and everything. And it doesn't bludgeon you over the head with satire and sex, kind of, you know, sort of like GTA does.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm enjoying it a bit more for that reason. Mm-hmm. And it knows the people it's poking fun at, the community it's poking fun at, really well. There are man buns. You know, it pokes fun at the likes of Mark Zuckerberg kind of appropriating the counterculture of things like the Burning Man Festival, where he's, you know, reportedly choppered in with his friends, which is kind of because they think they are the counterculture, but really they're becoming the establishment. So it does like fun things like that. You can be an Uber driver, sort of. You can get these little missions where you pick up random people and they want you to do weird things, like weird little crazy side missions and stuff. It's just quite fun, engaging world. And I was surprised, pleasantly surprised. So,
yeah.
I mean, it's not the greatest game of the year, but it's a good, solid game.
I've heard this sort of reaction from quite a lot of people. I'm actually kind of interested in playing it now after I've sort of turned off from the original watching a friend of mine playing it, and it just seemed like the most generic and boring thing.
Yeah, It was.
Yeah.
They turned it around.
Maybe I'll
like
get that
Ubisoft
in a year.
Does quite often.
Yeah, yeah.
It's kind of the Assassin's Creed sort of pattern.
Yeah, it's been a weird year for Ubisoft, isn't it? They didn't release a new Assassin's Creed. The new Far Cry was different.
Yeah, it's true. So, so Watch Dogs 2.
Excellent. I'm going to go with Hitman is my biggest surprise of the year.
Okay.
I was not expecting it to be good after Absolution, but I subscribe to the whole pack anyway because I've always been a Hitman fan, and there's no way I wasn't going to play the new one. And they've just made a really good set of Hitman levels there. The level packs that they're releasing are really expansive. There's lots to do in them. There's lots of different methods to you know achieve your goals, and I think episodic is a really, really good format for that because it means that like the best levels from the original Hitman games were the ones where they were like you got a whole hotel to yourself and you had to just you know look around, find whatever route you liked. There were huge branching paths, and doing one level a month has allowed them to take that up to 11 and just make the massive, massive levels with so much. There's just a load of replay value there, and it's just been a really good revival for that series.
Yeah, I haven't jumped onto Hitman, but I did write a column when they announced that and predicted that it would be a really, really perfect format for Hitman.
Yeah. I do kind of find myself missing some of the little smaller, tighter levels, but not enough to sort of counterbalance how good the big ones are.
Yeah, I think it's hitting quite a lot of best of lists.
Yeah.
Hitman. I know John, our editor, he loves Hitman, but I think he's really enjoying this, he said.
Yep.
Okay. So our next category is games we played the longest.
Yeah. I'll go first for this one.
Yeah.
I think anyone who's listened to the preceding season of the show will probably know what I've been spending most of my time on this year. So the 2016 game I played the most has to be Dark Souls. I think I must have played about... So 120 hours, maybe a bit longer than that this year, along with two other Dark Souls games, which I've been playing. Dark Souls 3, fantastic game, not as good as the previous two, I don't think.
Yeah.
But it's still Dark Souls, I still love it, and I've still done multiple playthroughs of it, doing lots of different runs, lots of different gimmicks. I've tried to do a pacifist run in it, where you, all sorts of different fun things you can do, different ways you can play the game.
Hmm.
Pacifist one is a pretty difficult one. You have to summon other players to fight for you, and they get annoyed if you don't fight, so just a weird gimmicky thing I decided to try out, and that was a lot of fun.
Excellent. So my played the longest is No Man's Sky.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a game that you have to play for a long time. You know, that's when you get the best out of it. You can't just grab, it's like, I'll grab 20 minutes of No Man's Sky because you won't have actually done anything. it's definitely the game that I sank the most solid hours at a time into. I enjoyed it. I know lots of people were disappointed, varying grades of disappointed. For me, it was pretty much the game I expected. As far as I was concerned, it was always a solo player, procedurally generated sort of space kind of, I don't know, not adventure exactly, but just almost survival thing. So exploration, that's the word I'm looking for. And that it delivered that for me. And I really liked the music, it was stunning. It looked great. And I liked the loneliness of it because it kind of made me feel like this tiny speck in a huge universe, and that is what they promised us, and on that level I think it delivered, and I enjoyed it for quite a long time. It sort of wore thin, but I enjoyed it and I played it for a good long hours.
Cool.
So our next one is Wow Moment.
Yeah.
Wow Moment Award.
Yeah. The best little thing or little moment in a game. Yeah. I guess we're going to take it in turns on who goes first.
Okay, so it's my turn. So I think It has to be the nose moment in Uncharted 4.
Yeah, I definitely considered that as well. That was just so nice, wasn't it? We talked about it at the time.
Yeah, the nose moment. I don't know if you've missed the episodes or episode where we've discussed this before, but in Uncharted 4, there's this moment where Nate and Elena kiss, and Elena's nose kind of squidges to the side, and it's just such a, oh my god, it's just such a beautifully observed tiny thing that makes them feel even more real than they feel already.
Yeah.
But for a gameplay wow moment, I think it has to be the Jeep drag in Uncharted 4 again.
Yeah.
I think there are a lot of Uncharted 4 moments that made me go, wow.
Yeah, you're talking about the bit where you're being dragged through the mud on the back.
Yeah,
that was just an amazingly fun little set piece.
Yeah.
I spent so much time like replaying that level and posing shots in the photo editor.
And I think it was one of the few, it didn't have as many set pieces, Uncharted 4, as the other games have had. I don't think not as many like big wow, you know, the sort of sunken cruise ship and, you know, the sort of plane crash and the train crash of the other ones, but that was one of them.
I mean, mine's from Uncharted 4 as well, and it's the Crash Bandicoot level. As I recall, I was spoiled for it in advance, which I thought was a really mean thing to do, but that's just such a nice little thing.
It is.
You know, if you're not expecting
it,
it's just such a surprise. I mean, if you haven't played Uncharted 4, I've spoiled it there for you. But I'm just as bad.
It's been almost a year. So.
I think we're past the spoiler barrier for that one.
I think we are. Yeah. So next on our list is
favorite.
Yes.
Yeah.
So an art style that we liked the most.
And for this, I'm going to go with a game that we covered on the podcast. It's going to be Virginia.
Okay.
I just really enjoyed it. It was 2 hours of, you know, sitting in Twin Peaks, basically. It was,
it
was really nice. It's so warmly toned. It's such a strange little town, strange little piece.
Mm-hmm.
I just really enjoyed the time I spent with that game.
It was a close second, I think, Virginia, the aesthetic on that. But I have gone with Banner Saga 2.
Oh, right.
I mean, it's just dreamy, the art style of Banner Saga 2. It's just so gorgeous, but I love it. I love every second. I love every cutscene. I love every dialogue screen. It's so beautiful. I can't get over it. Yeah, love it.
That's not a series I'm familiar with, so you keep telling me to go get into those games, and I think I'm going to have to.
Yeah, it's so beautiful. It's just, especially at this time of year, because it's all snow and sort of Norse, and it's gorgeous. It's actually my wallpaper on my laptop.
Oh, right.
I love it. Yeah, it's just one of the most beautiful games ever, hands down.
Yeah.
So probably this time next year, I'll be saying Banner Saga 3.
Look forward to it.
Okay, our next category is our favourite world. Sort of a world that I don't know, that we'd like to spend time in, or so it's slightly different to aesthetic.
Yeah.
Because I wouldn't like to actually be in the Banner Saga world. It's quite grim and cold. So is it you or is it me?
No, I think it's you.
Okay, so my favourite world is The Last Guardian.
Fair enough.
Yeah, it's kind of the team eco world, I suppose, really.
Yeah.
Because, you know, that is continuous. And I just find it really intriguing because nothing is made explicit in it. So there are these weird sort of villages, tribes of people, and there's these weird creatures and these huge towers. And, you know, I'm climbing up this tower and I'm thinking, who built these and what are they for? And I really love that about the games. I'd just like to fly around on the back of the creature from The Last Guardian and, you know, climb those towers, maybe with some safety ropes, but
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to getting my hands on that game and exploring it, because I love Shadow of the Colossus so much.
I'd maybe temper your moment.
Fair enough.
That's all I say. But it is a beautiful world.
Well, I sort of went the opposite way with this. My favourite world is not particularly a world I'd like to spend much time in, because I've gone for Dark Souls 3 again.
Yeah.
I'm not going to limit it specifically to the world of Dark Souls 3, but the world of Dark Souls, I always think, is just a really well-realized, interesting one. You know, loads of stuff to see, loads of detail that it doesn't tell you directly. Lots of stuff to just work out on your own, you know, come to your own conclusions on.
Yeah,
it was nice to get back to that this year. I won't go on about it anymore.
Please stop. What was next? Next up is the best sequel.
Best sequel.
Award.
Yeah, for this one, I've gone for Hitman again.
Okay.
Yeah. I thought about giving it to Uncharted 4, but I think Uncharted 4, what it did was, like, it was a fantastic sort of follow-up to the previous games. It's in the same style, it's the same sort of thing, but Hitman actually did something exciting with it. So that's what I've given it to, and I'm not going to go into that much further because I've already talked about it.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't played Hitman, so I gave it to Uncharted 4.
There we are, so yeah.
Yeah, so we're, like, pretty much on the same page on that one. Mm-hmm. Although it's not the best in the series, I don't think. But it was still such a great game.
Yeah.
Okay. So up next is most original.
Yep.
So is it me up first?
It is.
So I was kind of torn on this one, but I've given it to Virginia. I just loved the really cinematic style, the jump cuts, the sort of surreal element, dreamlike element, the way it sort of plays and unsettles you. I enjoyed that game a lot because of that.
Right. It's funny you say that, because at the end of Virginia, it plays. It has that message saying, in homage to 30 Flights of Loving, one of the Blendo Games releases. And my most original is another Blendo Games game. It's Quadrilateral Cowboy, which was released in the middle of the year, which is a fantastically sort of strange concept, which ended up working really well, and I haven't kind of finished it yet, but what I played was just really interesting. If you haven't played it, you play as a hacker who is designing bank heists. The premise of it is that you are in VR and you have a building which you're looking at, and it'll have security cameras, it'll have doors, and you have your own deck, sort of a laptop kind of thing. It's very much based on, like, Neuromancer, classic cyberpunk stuff. Mm-hmm. You kind of have to work out how to do a bank heists and robberies of houses by directly coding into your laptop commands for those for all the elements of the level. And it's there's nothing else quite like it. It's a very strange concept. I really enjoyed.
Best writing is up next.
Best writing, yeah.
That's me. You're up, I think.
So I've gone with Firewatch. All of the dialogue in that game I thought was fantastic. There was no point at which I was walking a lot. Obviously it wasn't, perfect. There's probably clunky moments in there that I've glossed over, but in general, walking around that world, there were no moments where I wasn't just sort of invested in the conversation that Henry and Delilah were having. I just thought it sort of invited you in really well, and then just sort of washed over me, and really loved it.
I almost went for Firewatch as well, but the ending just it lost me. So I have gone for Virginia again.
Okay.
And I was really torn with Inside or Virginia, because I think Inside was brilliantly written as well. Strangely, both games without any dialogue. But I just thought the storytelling was so good, and the emotion of the friendship and the betrayal and all the things that were said without saying anything, I just thought it was really clever, the way they did that. I thought the writing was fantastic in Virginia. I really enjoyed it. So next category. God, we're really rattling through these. Next category is the characters categories. So we are going on to best male characters. So it's me first, isn't it?
It is.
So, so we're sort of switching between the same games here because my best male is Henry from Firewatch. Mm. So I do agree that the dialogue between Henry and Delilah was fantastic. And, you know, I was really invested in his story right from the beginning, that opening with him and his wife and the dog and the way they set up the game. And although I didn't maybe agree with all the things Henry did or we did together, Henry, but yeah, I really liked him.
He is just like a charming and funny guy, and
he's just an every guy who and has the flaws of an every guy as well.
I had a bit of difficulty picking a best male character this year. I could have gone with Henry as well, to be honest, for reasons that will very shortly become apparent. I did. So I've gone for Victor Sullivan from Uncharted 4.
Yay.
And it's not as if he's a new character, and it's not as if he did anything particularly new in this game, or they didn't develop his character particularly strongly, but I never don't enjoy watching scenes that he's in.
No.
And I think he gets the best line in Uncharted 4, and it's at the auction where he and what's the bad guy's name? Rafe. He and Rafe are bidding on that whatever the artifact is, and then there's just a smaller side where he turns away, covers his mouth, and says into the radio, "Let's ruin this asshole." I just really loved that little moment. I think it's the funniest line in the whole game.
Yeah.
I just like.
Great.
Yeah.
And when he finds his shirt for sale in the market in Madagascar. Love it. Mm. Love it. So what have we got? Oh, so we have best female up next.
And
so that's you.
One of the reasons I didn't go for Henry is because it felt like a bit of a cop-out giving both of these awards to the same game, because I've gone with Delilah from Firewatch for this one. I thought she was a fantastically well-realized character. She's, you know, again, she's very likable, she's very charming, she's the funniest character in that game, which, there's only two characters, never huge Barticlea, but she is just genuinely funny and very believable and human. You know, there are moments in which she is very blasé and she's very, you know, they have this repartee with each other and they're all wisecracking, and then there are the scenes at night very vulnerable with each other.
Mm.
And I just thought she was a really well done character.
It's a believable relationship, isn't it?
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, now we're getting to the nitty gritty, and the next category is the most fun game.
Yep. So, you for this?
Yeah, sort of explains itself, really.
It does.
So my most fun game is Doom.
All right, yeah.
Yeah, I just I just had a really good time with it. It's just, you know, I always play these kind of worthy narrative-led, character-led indie flim-flom things, and so Doom is just got some cheesy metal playing over the top and big guns and just running and gunning. And I played it the night before I was going to Glastonbury Festival, and I was just like need to sit down, chill out, and just kick back, and Doom is perfect for doing that.
Yeah, absolutely. It was such a fun game. Everything else got out of the way, just got the action and the fun right up in your face and just let you go through it.
Exactly. Sometimes I'm not always artsy fartsy.
No. I actually have that as one of my honourable mentions in this category. The one I went for as most fun is Titanfall 2, which I was really surprised by. I didn't play the first one because it was multiplayer only, and I don't really care about multiplayer, especially not competitive multiplayer.
I expected that to be your biggest surprise.
It almost made that, but it's just such a, again, like Doom, it's a really fun, fast, fluid shooter. the movement mechanics in it, when you're not in the Titan, are fantastic. It's all wall running. It sets you up to do a lot of really cool kind of stunt moves. You know, you can run up a wall, shoot some guy, run over to the opposite wall, and I guess shoot some other guy. There's not a huge amount of verbs. But yeah, it's just a really fast-paced, fun, frenetic thing, which I'm really enjoying playing. And then, you know, occasionally you get to climb into a mech and do all sorts of crazy stuff with, like, be like Iron Man, based multi-tracking rocket launches, all sorts of different weapon loadouts, which are just a ton of fun. I haven't played much of the online, but I'm sure I will once I finish the single-player campaign, which I'm going to try and do this afternoon. Like I say, I had an honorable mention for Doom in this category, and I also just wanted to mention Overwatch. So it's a very FPS themed one, this one.
Yeah, there have been some good FPSs this year. We're down to our final two awards.
Yeah.
And first up is our favorite game.
Yeah.
Because we decided that maybe best game of 2016 might be different from our favorite game of 2016.
Yeah.
What was your favorite game of 2016?
Well,
drumroll.
I joined this podcast in January or February or something, wasn't it? So this is going to be a very symmetrical sort of ending. Because do you remember what the first game we covered was?
Firewatch.
It was Firewatch, and that's this year. So yeah, we've come full circle. I really love that game. I think it was the best game released this year. Well, not the best. This is my favorite game released this year.
I agree with
everybody, and walking simulators aren't, you know, everybody's cup of tea, but I thought that was a really fantastically well done one. I think it's the best example of the genre by quite some margin, and I know you said you didn't like the ending, but I think it achieved, like, exactly what it was going for with that ending, which was to say that, you know, all the plot stuff, the mystery stuff that went on in that game wasn't really the point. It didn't really match story. The story was about Henry, you know, basically figuring out that he was kind of being an asshole, and going back to, you know, learning his lesson and moving on. I thought it was really well written. I thought it was well realized. It's a world that I've played through it three times. Never don't enjoy just hiking around the Two Forks. I forget what the park is called, but
I can't remember.
No, but his station is Two Forks. I can't remember what the name of the full-on park is called. But yeah, that's my favorite game this year.
Yeah. Okay. My favorite game is Uncharted 4. Because this time, Christmas last year, I got the Uncharted remastered sort of trio.
Yeah.
And it was my best Christmas ever, because I had about a week to myself. My boyfriend Dave was at his parents. I sort of ran away and came back, like, chucked those games in, and I just gorged on Uncharted. Uncharted 4 came out at the beginning of the year, so it was just like a really nice ending to a complete binge fest. I sort of soaked in those games that people have been playing over a few years in a couple of months, basically. And it was really nice to play them so close together, because I could remember all the details of every game. And I just love those games, love those characters so much. It's a big fave. So this is it, the best game of 2016, and it's meeting you first, isn't it?
It is, yeah. I'm wondering what you're going to go for now, because I thought you were going to go Uncharted 4 for this.
I am going to go with Virginia.
Okay.
Yeah. I knew you'd say that. I was like, Drew's going to raise an eyebrow at this. I think it did a lot of important things in terms of diversity. I just really loved the story they told. I thought the art was fantastic. The really sort of simple, stripped back kind of art style, with just lovely lighting. And like I said before, the writing was I thought the writing was superb. And the fact that it had that surreal sort of ambiguity and unsettling thing, which you don't really get that often with games, and unless it's like a horror game or something, and they, and then they spoil it all by just putting some guts on the table or something. And it's just a game that stayed with me. I still sort of get flashes of images from that game. I just thought it was so strong. In terms of imagery and stuff, and I love David Lynch, so I'm a sucker for a noirish sort of suburban noir.
Yeah, very strange and unique genre, that one.
Yeah.
I've
nonplussed you. Yeah.
No, at all. You know, I can understand why you why you went for that. I don't think it grabbed me quite as much as it did you. I really enjoyed it. I thought, but there was stuff that I did enjoy so much about it. I still haven't. I know this is kind of the point, but I still kind of haven't got my head around what the ending, and not just what happened, but what kind of what it was going for.
Mm-hmm.
If you know what I mean.
Like me with Firewatch, basically.
Yeah.
I think Firewatch set up certain promises to the player in terms of narrative, that it then kind of just went, oh, no, that's not what we're really doing. It was a bait and switch, as far as I'm concerned. So, yeah.
All right, so my best game, I have gone for Uncharted 4. It's not my favourite game this year, but which, obviously, the previous category.
Okay, see, that is a surprise.
Yeah. All right, fair enough. I mean, just generally... as a game, I think that is the biggest achievement here. Just all around, it was a game that it delivered fully on everything you wanted from an Uncharted game and everything it promised.
It's true.
It was gorgeous throughout, exciting, it was fun, it was funny. It had these like wonderful human elements that Naughty Dog had learned from making The Last of Us 2. They really learned how to do sidekick characters really well. And they brought that into it. You know, the relationship between Nate and Sam is just really interesting to watch unfold. I think it was just that, like, the most complete package, the most well-made game released this year.
Yeah,
and even if
true.
It is, you know, it's kind of it's the big AAA game, and it's a little bit similar to the previous ones. I mean, there's still
if I was giving it
like
to
that.
A AAA, it would be Uncharted 4.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So those are our games of the year. Maybe we can agree that our ultimate game of the year is Uncharted 4 then.
I guess. I mean,
it was a really close thing for me between Uncharted 4 and Virginia. So, hats off to Naughty Dog for Uncharted 4, I think.
Yeah,
2016.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I was quite surprised that in all the categories we set out, we didn't agree on a single one.
I was just about to say exactly that.
So,
we were sort of gave the same games, you know, a lot of the same games, awards for different stuff.
Yeah, them for different stuff, yeah.
Yeah. So it was a tough year, though. There were no, like, clear standout winners, I don't think, because we had a really good year of games. Some years you're just like, okay, it's got to be COD or Far Cry.
I mean, the new Call of Duty is really good.
In general,
there were just a bunch of games that I was looking at which were really good this year, which kind of didn't make it into any of
the
categories.
So I was just about to say, there's like, we've got some honourable mentions because there are games that we think we might have slipped into some categories that we maybe haven't played yet or haven't played enough of, or just didn't make the grade but were so close. So if you want to go for some of those.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have anything particularly sort of insightful to say about any of these, but Super Hot came out this year, and that was a really sort of interesting take on FPSs and combat. Final Fantasy 15, I've sunk about 30 hours into it at this point, and that's really fantastic, and I don't think I've played enough of it to decide whether or not it deserves any awards, but I'm really enjoying it as a Final Fantasy fan. The Witness seems like it came out a lot longer ago than it did. I wouldn't have called that a game that came out this year if you'd asked, though it came out the same kind of about around the same time as Firewatch. That was a really sort of interesting puzzler. And what else was there? I mean, not much else. Pokemon Sun and Moon came out there, and I think they're probably the best Pokemon game in quite a while. I almost gave them best sequel, but didn't. And Pokemon Go almost got my most original award, even though it wasn't quite that original. It was Ingress, but with Pokemon.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's just loads of stuff that...
I'd like to mention Dishonored 2, which almost got my favourite world, because the detail in Dishonored 2 is just incredible. I want to fiddle with all of the machines that are on desks and things, and I just want to walk around Karnaca for a while, which feels like a sort of steampunk Prague, but not the Prague we know now, which is like full of sort of Russian tourist tat, but the Prague that I knew in like sort of 1990, when it had only just opened up to the West, and you know, sort of peeling posters for circuses on the wall and stuff. Yeah, it's a really rich world. So also Pavilion, which is a puzzler, kind of like Monument Valley.
Oh, yes, you did show me this. I never did get around to playing it.
Yeah, that would be a close one for aesthetic as well, because it's really beautiful, kind of weird, surreal, kind of classical sculptures and faces within faces, and yeah, these weird sort of topiary gardens you wander through, and then all of a sudden you're in a modern apartment, and yeah, it's like this kind of dreamscape, and really love that. If you like Monument Valley, it doesn't look the same, but it's got a similar kind of playing style to it. And then also Bound, loved Bound so much, which is the sort of balletic one. I don't know if you've seen it. It's kind of a motion-captured ballet dancer, and she's got like a ribbon, almost like a rhythmic gymnast.
Right.
And you go through this incredible sort of colourful sort of kaleidoscopic world that's like everything is kind of shimmers and moves, and when you touch a wall it kind of shimmers into like little triangles and stuff, and there are these things fluttering around you, and you kind of sort of fly down these kind of undulating paths that sort of go through this like brightly coloured sky. And yeah, that was really close to getting a favourite aesthetic as well, or a favourite world. And it's also in VR on PlayStation VR, so I think that would be a great game to do VR, because I just took so many pictures in that game. It was just stunning. I was just standing looking at the world. It was incredible, and it's a really nice game with a really interesting kind of story to it as well. You're sort of unlocking memories, kind of this woman's memories of her childhood and stuff. So that was a really great game that I think not many people played, with a great soundtrack as well, really nice piano.
It does sound really, really interesting. I think you have mentioned that to me at some point in one of our post podcast conversations.
It a go. It's not a very long game, but it's really lovely.
You talking about VR reminded me of just one more game that I wanted to mention, which was Land's End, which is the VR game from the makers of Monument Valley, which is it's not quite the same art style as Monument Valley, because it has to be in 3D, and it's kind of all sort of rock formations and structures and caves, and you sort of do fly-throughs of them in VR and solve puzzles within them, and it's just it's a really, really nice little game, and it was the best thing VR did this year. Well, I don't know about that. I haven't experienced a lot of what VR did this year, but it's definitely the best VR thing played. Just something I forgot to mention on my list was Oxenfree, which we did cover on the podcast, and I really enjoyed that as well. It wasn't fantastically written or anything, but it was a nice little sci-fi story with a nice little setting and atmosphere. And,
cool. I think we're done.
I think we are. I think we've officially completed the tosses for this year.
We have. And 2016.
And 2016, this is, the
end
last...
of season two.
It is,
wow. And your first season.
Yeah, I've completed one. Achievement unlocked.
So thank you, Drew, for being a really great co-host.
That's great. And, you know,
really enjoyed.
Thank you for letting me be one, and you've been a really great co-host yourself.
Well,
I really enjoy doing this. Here's to many more seasons.
Yes, to season three at the very least.
Yeah.
So, thank you to all our listeners for joining up and coming on the journey with us through through 2016. We'd like to know what your Tosser awards would be.
Yeah. In the comments, in the or email us or something.
Yeah. All those good things. We're there. You know where we are. You found us.
Yes.
So, well, have a good Christmas and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And here's to a really good year in gaming.
Yeah.
In 2017. See you, Drew.
See you next year. Thank you for listening. If you have enjoyed this episode of Are You the Toss, and why wouldn't you, you can find us on iTunes. Just search for Are You the Toss. You can also find our RSS feed on our main page at gameindustry.com. If you don't use iTunes and you use another podcast player, that should work fine with it.
We're also on SoundCloud. Look for Are You the Toss. Our host, of course, is gameindustry.com. So you can talk to us via the Twitter page there, which is at Gin Lounge. You can also find us on YouTube, and Game Industry News is also on Facebook, on Google Plus, and all those good social media things. So give us a thumbs up, give us a like, tell us what you like. It's awesome. You're awesome for listening. Thank you so much.
Nailed it.